So my presentation today is about the evolution of special effects in Star Wars between 1977 to 2019. I'm a pretty big Star Wars fan. Actually, I didn't watch the movies until 2015, which I know is kind of late, but I just never got around to it until The Force Awakens was coming out, and I just really wanted to see what it was all about. So I sat down with my mom, we watched 4, 5, and 6, 1, 2, and 3, and then we went to go watch 7 in theaters. And since then, I've been a pretty crazy Star Wars fan. You can see my Baby Yoda plushie, the Squishmallow right here. This project was really interesting to me, being able to choose my own topic, because the special effects in Star Wars is something that I've begun to notice as I watch the movies over and over again. I'm kind of catching things that I didn't see the first time around, and I thought it was pretty cool. In the beginning, George Lucas developed a division within Lucasfilm called Industrial Light and Magic, or ILM. And this division was solely dedicated to figuring out how to do the special effects that they needed for Star Wars that kind of hadn't been invented yet. For the original trilogy, much of the special effects was done with like physical creations of models and puppets and miniatures all built from scratch. And they were essentially filmed super up close with a blue screen in the background, but it was kind of made to look more realistic because they couldn't exactly have a life-size Millennium Falcon to film just right outside. A lot of the aliens and other creatures in the original trilogy are also filmed using puppets and stop-motion animation. Stop-motion is kind of the idea that it is, but really ILM created this new technique called Go Motion, in which essentially a computer was puppeteering these miniatures to give it a more realistic look. So they essentially picked out the frames that would kind of give the most realistic and smooth transition between poses. Yeah, so back in 1977, CGI wasn't where it is now, and it wasn't where they needed it to be either. So most of the alien creatures were either people dressed up in costumes or puppets. One of these being Jabba the Hutt. And if you have seen an original version of Star Wars A New Hope, you'll see Jabba looks a bit different than he does in the newer version on Disney Plus and newer DVDs, where he is CGI animated and kind of looks a little bit out of place. And one of the characters in the original trilogy who was a puppet was Master Yoda. He was basically an animatronic puppet that was controlled, would walk around, but you could watch the movie and definitely tell he is a puppet. But in the prequel trilogy, which started in 1999 and last movie was released in 2005, Yoda is pretty much completely animated, and this allows him a lot more freedom to do cooler fight scenes and do fun flips around and use the Force. But it's definitely a big difference if you compare him in episode 5 versus episode 2. With CGI being more improved than it was in 1977, they were able to add in a lot of really cool animated and digitalized backgrounds and spaceships and pretty much everything in the prequel trilogy. Most of it was actually done in post. So a lot of filming for the prequels was just kind of the actors walking around on a makeshift set that wasn't the whole finished product, and lots of blue screen and green screen. And one of the first fully digitized, completely animated characters in film, and the first one in Star Wars, was actually Jar Jar Binks. So Jar Jar Binks was played by actor Ahmed Best in a motion capture suit that was digitally replaced in post to completely animate Jar Jar Binks. And that's one of the reasons that he stood out so much, is because everyone else around him is played by a real person on screen. And him being animated, it just, CGI wasn't what it is today. And because at the time it was still relatively newer, it just wasn't as smooth. And reviews from the time say that viewers didn't really connect with Jar Jar because of this. And honestly, whether people didn't connect with him because he didn't move as smoothly or because he's actually a Sith, he was responsible for the rise of the Empire, is a discussion for another time. But the point is, he doesn't look as realistic as he could with today's technology. But he does look more realistic than he would have in 1977's technology. Now for the sequel trilogy. Despite me not really believing that it's completely canon, it is pretty much a visual masterpiece to watch. The opening scenes with Rey kind of salvaging around the broken spaceship, watching it, you would never be able to tell that like 90% of the background you're seeing isn't even there. She really only had a few real life props in front of her to interact with, and the rest of it was completely green screened. And more about the CGI, by 2015 CGI was a lot better than it was in 2005, and some of the more alien species in the Star Wars universe at this time were also CGI'd. Kind of like Maz Kanata, the one character who helps Rey in the movie. She was also played by an actor in a motion capture suit, but by this point the actions were kind of able to be made more fluid and realistic, and that's why she doesn't look quite as out of place as Jar Jar Binks. Now onto The Mandalorian. Technically not one of the movies in the saga, but it still is part of the Star Wars universe and technically fits within the time range I gave because it came out in 2019. So The Mandalorian was actually one of the driving forces behind me choosing this topic after I watched the behind the scenes Disney Plus show showing how they made The Mandalorian. And it was episode 6 specifically that really inspired me for this project. So in episode 6 of the Disney Plus show, they're describing how they filmed a lot of the Mandalorian scenes. And they basically shot most of the show in this 75-foot diameter circular stage in LA called The Volume. And The Volume is filled with thousands of high-definition LED screens covering the entire room, like 360. The screens are able to simulate any landscape that they can put into the computer. If they can make it in the computer, the screens will be able to simulate it and make it look like a realistic environment, as if you're actually there, because it is 360 degrees, you basically are there. And the high definition LED lights also offer dynamic lighting, so if the sky is clear and blue, it's almost like there's sunshine shining on you. If it's cloudy, you know, you have a little bit of a shadow over you, and it just looks super realistic. The creator of the show, Jon Favreau, actually got this idea from his past experience working on the live-action Lion King and The Jungle Book, in which they kind of use similar technology with like LED screens and virtual reality to kind of, for those movies, give a preview for how they were going to map out the green screen key points. And he and his team kind of took that technology to the next level for Mandalorian and made it a real-time changing background, which worked out really well. So essentially there would be real-life props in the foreground and that the characters could interact with, and then maybe like half of the Razor Crest in the background so that the Mandalorian could get onto his ship and, you know, they would just cut it there. But besides those few props, and like the sand around them maybe, the rest of the environment was completely digital and through the LED screens, and you would never know watching it because it is so seamless. And the way that this works is that the computer, which has the environment uploaded into it with all the details and graphics and everything, it essentially communicates with the cameras and the LED screens. So when the cameras move around, the environment changes with it. What's also really cool about this is that it kind of makes life easier in post-production when it comes to editing the final footage. So what they would normally do is have a green screen, but the thing is, the Mandalorian's armor and his ship is super reflective. It's a shiny silver metal that, like, it just reflects things, you know, you can see colors bounce off of it. And if they had used green screen, they would have to go in and basically paint over the green reflections and kind of figure out, oh, what would be reflecting on this point. But with the dynamic lighting in a realistic environment, the lighting kind of does it all for them. The only thing they really have to worry about is whether or not the cameras they're filming with will reflect off of the armor, which those can be easily fixed rather than a green screen. Now onto the really fun stuff. So the lightsabers in the original trilogy were pretty tricky to film. So producer Gary Kurtz on episode 4 tried using this frontal projection material on the lightsaber blades, and having some kind of beam splitter on the front part of the camera, and essentially the projection material would reflect light to the beam splitter, and it would just kind of help create this glow effect on the blade. And so the actors were essentially swinging around a hilt with a clear plastic blade that had stuff on the front of it. Thing is, this only worked when the fights were happening kind of parallel to the camera. And that wasn't always the case, because you gotta get cool angles and different front shots of the different characters getting ready for battle. So what they ended up doing was rotoscoping the lightsaber effects over the sabers frame by frame. And this kind of gives a more shaky effect. If you watch A New Hope, you'll kind of be able to see that the lightsabers aren't perfect and the fight scenes aren't incredibly complicated, because they did have to rotoscope frame by frame, and it would make it a lot harder if they were moving around everywhere. Yeah, but by the prequel trilogy, 2005, technology had already improved a bit. CGI had already improved a bit. And the prequels had some amazing lightsaber duels. I'm talking about flips and tricks and spins and all of that. So the props that the actors used kind of looked more like Target lightsabers, like the toys, you know? They had a hilt and everything, which looked realistic, but the blade wasn't clear in plastic, but it was colorful and rounded like the ones that you would get from a toy store. But this was kind of an improvement that made it easier to edit over the lightsaber effects, because they would be able to kind of convert the brightly colored plastic from the lightsabers into the iconic beams of light in post. And that allowed for more complicated lightsaber battles. In the sequel trilogy though, the prop sabers were a lot more realistic. Actors Daisy Ridley and John Boyega, who played Rey and Finn, they actually commented on the weight of the hilts that were just a lot heavier, and it really felt like swinging around a giant weapon, which made the fighting and the acting a lot more realistic. Furthermore, the lightsabers actually glowed more like Target lightsabers. You know, you push a button and it lights up, but this allowed kind of more realistic lighting and made it easier on the special effects team afterwards, because they could see where the lightsaber is glowing and how it interacts with the environment around them. And if you compare it to the earlier series, even the prequels, where they had already used colorful lightsaber props, they don't really glow on the things around them. The lightsaber itself glows, but there's no interaction dynamically with the environment. In the sequel trilogy, the lightsaber glows and illuminates everything around it, because it's dark and light glows, and I mean, what else is gonna happen? So this project doesn't really add anything to me professionally. I'm really fortunate to have taken this class, because I've never done anything in film, and I was worried I was missing out and maybe I was gonna find my passion in this class, and I ended up not, but that's okay. Because I did find my passion in another class with live TV stuff. I'm just really excited that I got to work on this movie, and also this project specifically has given me a chance to explore something that I'm kind of passionate about. I think special effects are super cool, and though I don't think I have the capacity to either animate special effects or do all that in a computer, I still really appreciate watching it. And so this project has kind of been more of a personal research project for me rather than professional, but you know, I always thought Star Wars was cool, but I never realized just how cool it was. And so I'm really happy to have been able to do this, and I hope I can answer any questions that y'all have. Thanks.